Bam, it's true. In this video, we're going to take a look at solving trig equations again. This time with multiple angles. This will be a second type of video I do like this. But the first one, the difference is, had a restriction on the values that I was looking for, where I wanted theta to be between 0 and 2 pi. Here we're going to be looking for all solutions. So we're going to take a look at negative 2 sine of x over 2. This is the multiple angle I'm talking about, where it's not just a single sine of x, cosine of x, tangent of x, and so on. It's 1 half x. It's got an adjustment on the angle size. Minus square root of 3. So we only have one term with the trig function in it, so we're going to isolate it and see what we get. We're going to add square root of 3 from both to both sides. We're going to divide both sides by negative 2. We're going to get the sine function away from our angle. Remember, it's an angle measure we put into trig functions by doing inverse sine. And we get x over 2 equals the inverse sine of negative square root of 3 over 2. Now, if we were looking for answers that restricted, that we had restricted answers between 0 and 2 pi, this equation actually would not have a solution, because when you have a half angle in your trig function, if you have a half angle, when you talk about your unit circle, you're only going to go halfway around it, so that when you multiply by 2, you'll have all your angle measures be between 0 and 2 pi or 360 if you're doing degrees. Well, so if we had a restriction on our values that we're allowed to give as answers, this would actually have no solution. But since we don't, and we're looking for all possible solutions, we're going to go around this unit circle until we find those angle measures. That's what you get from an inverse trig function, those angle measures that give you a sine value which is equal to negative square root of 3 over 2. And the sine function is y over r, so it's the y values on the unit circle. And we have one here at 4 pi over 3 and 5 pi over 3, or angles in quadrant 3 and 4, where the sine function is indeed going to give you a negative ratio. So x over 2 is equal to 4 pi over 3 and 5 pi over 3, but we weren't asked to solve for the angle measure that's inside the sine function of x over 2. We're trying to solve for x. So we're going to multiply everything by 2 to get rid of this division of 2. Just put it all the way through that, I guess you could argue that really two equations here, but because x over 2 equals 4 third pi, and x over 2 equals 5 thirds pi. But anyway, we're going to multiply everything by 2 and get x is equal to 2 times 4 is 8 over 3. So 8 pi over 3, and 2 times 5 pi over 3, which is 10 pi over 3. Leaving some space, because I know I'm going to have to add a little bit of I'm going to have to add something to these answers to express that I'm looking for all possible answers, not just these two specific angle measures. And please note again that these are outside the standard restricted values for your answers with these questions of 0 to 2 pi or 0 and 360. So, what do I need to add to these expressions to show that I'm looking or I'm accepting all possible solutions? Well, I need to do a plus. Let's see, where's another color here? I need to add in the period of the function times n. Well, what is the period? When you remember graphing, like y equals sine of x over 2, if you were graphing this, you'd be graphing y equals the sine of 1 half x. It's probably how I'd look at it in the section of your book where you're graphing. This is the value of b, and period for sine, cosine, secant, and cosecant is 2 pi over b. For tangent and cotangent, it's only pi. So the period of this trig function of sine of x over 2 or the sine of 1 half x is 2 pi divided by 1 half. And the period, let me write it out. 2 pi divided by 1 half is equal to taking the 1 half that's in the denominator and flipping it up. So it's 2 pi multiplied by the denominator, the 1 half flipped up, so the period is actually going to be 4 pi. So one, we're going to start listing all of our possible solutions by taking 8 pi over 3 and saying that we're going to allow it to be added by 4 pi, the period of this trig function, n, where n is an integer. N can be like negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It allows any full rotation of this period, and we're going to get more and more and more and an infinite number of angle measures that will satisfy this equation. And do the same thing with 10 pi over 3, add that by the period of the function, and then multiply it by n again, where n is an integer. So, that's example 1. I got one more coming. Woo! For our last example, we have the sine of 4x plus the sine of 2x equals 0. Now, it looks like we should be able to solve this. We got the same trig function, and should just be a little factoring and get done. But we have an angle of 4x and we have an angle of 2x. That might as well be a sine and a cosine function. This normally, this is basically kind of like having two variables in the same equation, and you can't solve for two variables when there's only one equation, unless you happen to be really, really lucky and those two variables factor apart. So we're going to take a double angle identity, and that will allow us to reduce this angle measure of 4x and bring it down to a measure of angle of 2x. And we're going to use the identity the sine of 2x is equal to 2 cosine x sine x. But of course, this is not a 2x, it's 4x, but it doesn't really matter that this is 1s and this is 2s, is that this angle measure is double what we have on the other side of the identity. So this is the identity I'm going to use, except there's going to be a 4x here, so these will be 2x's. So this identity substitution will get all of our measurements, or angle measures, to be the same size. So that's, we're getting closer to getting ready to solve this. But now we've got two different trig functions. We have sine and cosine. So still we have an issue here with, again, the two variables, you know, basically with the in the same equation, and that could be a problem, except both of these terms have a sine of 2x. So we can factor that out, undistribute that sine of 2x, and get the sine of 2x times the sine, the 2 sine 2x, cosine 2x, take out the sine of 2x, and we get 2 cosine of 2x, and sine of 2x divided by sine of 2x, of course, is 1. Got it factored, set each one equal to 0. Get each trig function alone, sine is already alone, and so we're going to subtract by 1 and divide by 2. So we get cosine of 2x equals negative 1 half, and we're going to get those trig functions away from those angle measures by doing the inverse trig function. So 2x is equal to the inverse sine of 0, and 2x is equal to the inverse cosine of negative 1 half. Now, if we were only concerned about getting our values of x between 0 and 2 pi, or 0 to 360 if you're doing degrees, then I would need to go around the unit circle twice and collect all of the possible answers so then I could divide them by 2 and get all possible solutions between 0 and 2 pi. But we're looking for all of the solutions, not just ones within a restricted range. So we're going to not worry about going around this unit circle twice. I'm just going to do it once, find the angles I need, and then add some little expressions there at the end to show that I want all possible solutions. Inverse sine of 0, where on this unit circle is the sine value equal to 0, where the y is 0 at 0 and pi. And over here we've got I knew I forgot something. 2x equals 0 and pi. And now we have 2x is equal to inverse cosine of negative 1 half. Where is my cosine? Negative 1 half. Where is the x values? Negative 1 half. At 2 pi over 3 and 4 pi over 3. Okay, we're solving for x. We're going to divide everything by 2. So dividing both sides by 2, we have x is equal to 0 and pi over 2. Dividing everything by 2 over here, or because we have fractions, multiplying everything by 1 half, we get 2 times a half is just simply x. So, and then 1 half times 2 thirds. The 2's are going to cancel out, giving me pi over 3. And I'm running out of room here. 1 half times 4 over 3. 4 divided by 2 is equal to 2. So we have x equals 2 pi over 3. A little sloppy there. And we have our four solutions that we need, but I don't want four solutions, I want all possible solutions. So let's think back to the previous example. We have a b value of 2. We have a sine function and we have a cosine function. The period of both of those trig functions is 2 pi, so the period of 2 pi divided by b. So each of these functions, because they're a double angle, when you were to go to graph them, they would oscillate and do a full period within a distance, a horizontal distance of pi. So unlike the previous example, here we only have a period of pi. So to, again, express that you want all possible solutions, you're going to go to each one of these and add in that it's going to be this answer plus the period pi n, again, where n is an integer. And when you're done with that, you'll have listed all your possible solutions. So 0 plus pi, the period, times n. Pi over 2 plus pi over times n. Pi over 3 plus pi n. And 2 pi over 3 plus pi n. And there, we've done. We have answered or given all possible solutions to our last example. I'm Mr. Taru. Go do your homework.